Views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of the staff or management of KLAV.
Standing up for families throughout Nevada, telling the stories of working women and men. This is our voice and our community. We are Nevada with your hosts, Leonard Carnelli and Nick DeArchangel.
Come on, rise up. Come on, rise up. Come on, rise up. Come on, rise up. Come on, rise up.
Good morning. This is Leonard Carnelli and Nick DeArchangel, and we're coming to you from the new We Are Nevada Talk radio show. Good morning to all the listeners and all our fellow union members out there and other listeners. This morning we're going to talk about some labor, some This Week in Review, and we have some guests here from the medical field and an interview. How you doing this morning, Nick?
Oh, fantastic. I'm so excited about this. And this is going to be every Friday morning at 9 a.m. where we get a chance to talk about the issues that affect working families and, our, like you said, our union brothers and sisters. But most importantly, we're here to give a voice to working families and to everyone out there about these issues that affect us. Leonard, do you want to just tell everybody about what is We Are Nevada besides an awesome radio show every Friday morning?
Oh, sure. Thanks, Nick. We Are Nevada is a public employee coalition, but it's not just public employees. We also have non-union members. The unions consist of the medical field employees, police, fire. We also have groups like Progress Now, Plan, NARA, which is the seniors, and we also have the teachers. We have the state teachers representing, and we also have the county teachers. And we kind of got together and decided that we need to bring the issues forward to the public that are important to us, that are important to Nevada, that are important to labor, that are important to the future of Nevada, and making sure that education and public safety and the medical field are all understood for what we stand for.
Yeah,
and provide some information to the public and to our members as well.
Yeah, I mean, every Friday morning from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. here on 1230 a.m. KLAV, the new We Are Nevada, we're going to be streaming live on the internet at www.klav1230am.com. And listeners will hear our issues from our voices. And we'll talk to our frontline workers throughout the state, both in Southern Nevada and in the North. And we'll be talking about our concerns and issues as we move towards the next legislative session. You know, we're going to cover everything. We're going to talk about the pension system. We're going to dispel all that garbage data that's being pushed out by special interest groups. You know, listeners will get unedited insight, you know, talking about our issues, you know, instead of relying on these cut down 7-second sound bites or half quotes that we see in the newspaper. You know, this is We Are Nevada. This is our show. This is our voice.
Yeah, we have some interesting guests coming up next week. We will have Lynn Warney from NSEA. She's a president of the State Teachers Union. And the following week, we'll have Aaron Neff from Progress Now coming on, talk to us a little bit about the Democratic Party and the upcoming elections and some voter registration.
All right, so let's take a look at things that happened in the news this week. We had a pretty busy week. One of the things that got a lot of ink was what really did not happen with the RTC, the Regional Transportation Commission. And actually, you know what? Before I get into that, we were talking a little bit before the show about the terrible events that happened in Colorado, and it's tough not to talk about that because it's such a big event that happened. This terrible shooting that happened at this movie theater at a midnight showing of a film, and you know, our hearts definitely go out to the families of the victims. And you know, this is another case. I was looking at some of the reports and I was reading descriptions of some of the things that were happening. And of course, you know, the first responders, the public employees, are there, and they're the first ones to respond, the first ones rushing to a scene. And Leonard, as someone like myself who's from North Jersey, we know all about what it's like when there's a disaster, and the brave public servants, they are running towards a place that your instincts are telling you to run away from. And I know that you know, we didn't really talk about who we are, but you are a sergeant in North Las Vegas. And you know, did you have anything that you wanted to mention about that?
Well, it's interesting that you bring that up. And our prayers do go out to the families and the victims of that shooting. And it's it is difficult as a first responder. I have been on scenes where they were pretty. There was a lot of bad things happening when we got there, and I can't imagine what the first responders thought when they showed up, and there were several people dead and several people hurt, and of course the police show up and they have to lock the place down, and they caught the gentleman in the parking lot. Unfortunately, he did not want to shoot it out with the police, so they did take him into custody.
Well, like you said, our prayers and our thoughts are with those families, and we'll be watching this as it develops. As I started talking about, then this week we had a situation with the Regional Transportation Commission, the collective bargaining agreement that was agreed on between management and also members, that it was overwhelmingly ratified. There was an unusual twist. Well, management was happy with the deal they got, and like I mentioned, union members voted overwhelmingly to accept the deal, but the county commissioners, they said they wanted more time to review the details. It's the first time I've ever actually seen this, and it's more unusual because this agreement is unique. It ties pay increases to revenue increases that the agency would realize. So in other words, if the rest of the community is doing well and there's money flowing into the agency, then public workers could qualify for a pay increase. But on the other hand, right, so if there's an economic crisis or a downturn, then public employees forgo that increase. So it seems like a very, very fair type of deal, something that benefits the taxpayers, but it's also fair to the workers. And, one of the RTC's commissioners, they were referring to a prepared comparison of deals from other agencies, and they noted that other agencies had negotiated this freeze or they wouldn't receive increases. Now, look, it wasn't clear where this comparison came from, but it's kind of reminiscent of a similarly skewed apples to oranges report that I saw surface during Clark County bargaining with SEIU. But, it's not clear what's going to happen if the board doesn't approve this deal at the next commissioner meeting. There were some interesting things that came out of this meeting that I attended, this public meeting, and management, they clearly expressed that if the agreement went to a third-party arbitrator, that they would find that the RTC could afford to pay these increases. So the details were discussed at length, and we'll see at the August board meeting whether or not the commissioners will sign off of the deal or send it back to the two parties to work on. So that'll be kind of interesting. The other thing that happened, which was kind of striking because there were two big reports that came out about hospitals, and one was a Consumer Reports releasing their rankings on hospital safety, and then U.S. News gave their rankings on best hospitals. And we'll talk a little bit more about that when our healthcare guests, when they come in and talk to us about healthcare in the Valley and the quality issues that they want to discuss. So, Leonard, I got to tell you that right now I have a little bit of a surprise. I really didn't give you a heads up on this. And I'm sorry to spring this on you the first show because I can see that you're a little bit jittery over.
Oh yeah,
new show.
Yes, very, very. Yeah.
But I'll come clean. I was thinking about a way last night to get our guests into the studio here without tearing the place apart, and I dug up some labor music that I found, and I found this tune by Tom Chapin, and it was written in the mid 1980s. Chapin is known for his children's recordings. He calls them family recordings. They look pretty interesting. But he's also known for his activism and keeping arts in the schools. And this song, it's called Small Business Blues off his album, Let Me Back Into Your Life. And it was described in all the descriptions I was looking at as an anti-import song. And you'll hear it's kind of dated because he talks about imports from places that they were talking about in the 80s. But I really feel like it says a lot more about corporations. And when you hear the words, I think you may or may not agree. So let's listen to it. This is, again, Tom Chapin, and it's called Small Business Blues.
Great.
I had lunch at Zip's Diner the other day, got a dollar bill for my change, and the words scribbled under old George's picture, well, it made me feel sad and strange. They said, good luck, Joe, and written down low, they said, we wish you all of the best. Now Joe's out of luck, and his very first buck's gone down the drain with the rest. First dollar on the wall, make you feel like standing tall. Got your future in your hands, proud to be a citizen of this land.
Then they put in the mall selling cheap foreign junk like plastic Korean shoes. And all the hard-working folk watch the business go broke, got the small business blues. Don't say America's gone lazy, it's the economy gone crazy. Yeah, if it don't change, we're gonna lose, got the small business blues. I was working in a textile printing plant, making lots of money back in 68. And by 75, we doubled production, but the bank says too late. 300 families thrown out of work, shut down by a plant overseas. Now who owns that foreign sweatshop? I don't know, but the locks have American keys. First dollar on the wall, make you feel like standing tall. Got your future in your hands, proud to be a citizen of this land. They're squeezing the small folk right out of business in the name of free enterprise. There's 10 million people out of work right now while the corporate skyscrapers rise. Don't say America's gone lazy, it's the economy gone crazy. Yeah, if it don't change, we're gonna lose, got the small business blues. First dollar on the wall, make you feel like standing tall. Got your future in your hands, proud to be a citizen of this land. We used to be farmers, mechanics, and builders, making houses out of local white pine. Now we're all sweeping floors in the shopping malls or standing on the food stamp line. Don't say America's gone lazy, it's the economy gone crazy. Yeah, if it don't change, we're gonna lose, got the small business blues. Yeah, if it don't change, we're gonna lose, I got the small business blues. Okay,
you are listening to the new We Are Nevada, your voice on the radio about issues that affect all of Nevada's working families. We Are Nevada can be heard every Friday morning at 9 a.m. on KLAV 1230 a.m. or streaming live on the internet at klav1230am.com. Well, I am very excited to start our new We Are Nevada show this morning with our very first guests. We have with us not just Southern Nevada healthcare professionals, but also we have people that are advocates for quality patient care in Southern Nevada. They are looking out for our weakest members of our society, and they are here to talk to us about the issues that are facing them every day in the workplace. I want to welcome everybody to the show. How are you all?
Very good.
Very good.
Hey, all right. I hear voices. And that's, for you healthcare professionals, not an indication of something going wrong in my head. I'm just happy that I hear your voices. So let's start out right off the bat, just introducing yourselves and telling me a little bit about your experience, and we'll start right here to my left.
Okay, I'm Fredo. I've been a nurse for 30 years, approximately. I'm also a trustee at SEIU 1107, which is our union for several of the hospitals in the area.
Fredo, welcome.
My name is Jerry, and I'm a nurse and in the community. I graduated from UNLV. I've spent all my 30 years here at one institution, have worked part-time for a couple of others, and I represent a large group of nurses at the only public hospital.
All right, Stephen, how are you doing this morning?
I'm doing very well, Nick, thank you. I'm Stephen Knaus. I am the local's healthcare division director.
Now, one thing I should mention, I feel like maybe, Leonard, we need a sound effect or something, but we currently have three people from New Jersey in the room, myself, Leonard, and now Stephen. So I feel like we you know, something to designate that. I think if there's more than two at any time, there needs to be some sort of, you know, rule imposed or something like that.
We should have Springsteen in the background.
That's right. And let me, if you didn't notice, that was in the opening. And let me introduce our last guest, Jane, a nurse here in Southern Nevada. And could you tell us a little bit about your experience in healthcare?
Yes, I've been a nurse for about 8 years here in the Valley, and I work at one of the local hospitals.
All right. Well, very good. Thank you all for showing up this morning here on our first show. I'm very honored to have you all here, and I hope you enjoy yourselves. Let's talk a little bit about what's happening tomorrow morning, the Healthcare Summit. And Stephen, why don't you give us an overview about this really exciting program?
Sure. SEIU is holding its first Healthcare Summit, which is essentially a meeting of about 150 healthcare leaders from our union who work in the 11 hospitals in Nevada where SEIU represents healthcare professionals. So these folks are coming together to discuss the current crisis facing healthcare workers in Nevada with regards to their working conditions, which is something that ultimately affects the quality of patient care in our hospitals. So these SEIU members will be discussing our locals' legislative priorities, first and foremost, of which is safe staffing legislation for our hospitals. At the end of the day, improvements in staffing equal improvements in the quality of patient care, and this means better patient outcomes. The members of SEIU believe that staffing legislation needs to include all healthcare workers in the hospital, from those who clean the facility to those who perform services in the lab, to those many classifications who provide direct patient care, up to and including nurses. So staffing is SEIU's number one priority, and we're really excited about tomorrow's Healthcare Summit.
All right, and I'll open this one up to the group here. Tell me about the work that you did leading up to the summit. You know, how'd you get to this point? Jerry?
Well, we talked to people about what was going on, and it seemed to be that there's a theme, according to all of us, which is that the administrators, the leaders at the hospitals get together and talk about how they're going to, what they're going to do with the staffing while we're busy doing our jobs. So, you know, as a result of what happens to us, we have decided that we can, in the public interest, we need to start having a voice in what happens at our workplaces.
All right, and Fredo, did you want to add something there?
Actually, a while back, we took legislation. We were fighting for safe staffing, and we had legislation out there, and we were fought by the Hospital Association, and the bill that finally passed was not what we were looking for, and so we're talking about now formulating something. California, for instance, has nurse-to-patient ratios. What happened in California, unfortunately, is that once they got their nurse-to-patient ratios, they started to take away their ancillary staff. So the nurses now had less patients but more work to do. So therefore, the patient care did not improve as much as they were hoping to it would. Here in the Valley, we see the trend because we have 10,500 approximately workers, healthcare workers in our union. We see that the trend, and we've all gotten together, like Jerry was saying, and started talking about the trends in the different hospitals, and decided that we should join together because it's what we want here is safe staffing ratios rather than nurse to patient ratios, because we don't want that to happen. And we already see the some of the hospitals are taking away the ancillary people before our ancillary workers before we even have the ratios. So maybe in anticipation of us looking for nurse to patient ratios, but that's not what we're looking for. The nurses cannot do our job without our ancillary people, and we see that that's the trend, and we want to get rolling on this so that it doesn't affect patient care any more than it already has.
All right, well, give me an idea, a day-to-day type of idea of what's going on as far as one of the risks to both nurses and other healthcare workers when a unit is short-staffed?
Well, I believe that the risk to the nurses is, one, that they take their license and risk every day that they go into the facility. The patients have a risk because they're not being cared for the way that they should be. We have ancillary staff, meaning our certified nursing assistants, our unit secretaries. They're all vital parts of what we do. And even the people, going down to the people that clean the rooms, if they're not there to help us, we can't take care of our patients properly. We're doing their jobs as well.
And as far as the public is concerned, I mean, one of the reasons why we're here this morning is to raise awareness, right? Do you think that there's a general awareness with the public? And anybody can answer this one.
I would say anybody who's had a family member in a hospital and had to wait for a nurse or to tend to their needs because the nurse was too busy taking care of too many patients would understand.
Well, one of the things we know that these reports came out this week, both in U.S. News and then Consumer Reports came out with another study, and Fox News covered on it, local Fox News covered it, and they were talking to people standing outside of hospitals, and they were man on the street interviews just asking them what they thought the problem was. And I thought it was really interesting to hear people say, well, it's obvious there aren't enough people working in there. They don't have the help. If there isn't, there was a great quote that one guy said where he said, if there aren't enough people, there isn't enough care. And did you guys hear that? And how did that strike you, that people were actually saying what you're saying here?
Well, I didn't hear it personally because I don't watch that particular channel. However, I think it makes sense that we stop underrating the public's intelligence and figure out that they're going to catch on to what we've known for years. You can't get somebody in a room to help get somebody out of bed if they have four or five other patients that are having a higher priority of needs. It can't happen. The other thing is that there's no coverage for when people take breaks. You end up, we're in a vicious cycle here. It's not that the nurses don't care. They get up every day. They try to figure out how they're going to take the best care of people that they can. And it seems like when you get to work and actually start doing the care, there's so many roadblocks in the way, the first of which is staffing.
Mm-hmm. And tell me about the aspects of patient care. You know, what are the aspects of patient care that suffer when there just isn't enough staff on the floor?
Oh, everything suffers. I think every patient suffers. Every patient has to wait. You have to prioritize everything you do from the minute you start to the minute you stop. And I don't know how it's going to end. I'm not sure. The only way it can is if we get the safe staffing ratios.
When hospitals talk about balancing their budgets or their profit margin and things like that, they talk about staffing as a big part of their budget. But what they don't understand is that if they would increase their staffing to a level that would where we'd be able to take care of the patients proficiently, that their infection rates would go down, their complications would go down, and their profit margin would go up. They just don't understand that because they want the short fix. They want the money now. The Affordable Care Act hopefully will make them answer to some of these things and make them think twice about, if you have an infection that was acquired in the hospital, the government's not going to pay for it. Mm-hmm. So these things, the hospitals are finally looking at it, but they're saying, how are we going to manage this? And I don't know that they're looking at staffing, and I think they need to, because mm-hmm. that's the number one thing that cuts down on infection rates, that cuts down on it cuts down on deaths.
And can I add something to that? You can drill it down to the simplest terms. Is the big thing in the public is antimicrobial hand wash. Hand washing's the most important thing, alcohol sanitizers. But if a nurse is rushing from one patient to the other, there's no intent not to wash your hands, but there could be something as simple as, I have got to get in there, that's my priority, and that those things go by the wayside. Hopefully not, but you can't say that human beings helping other human beings aren't going to make some mistakes when it's always do one more thing, do it faster, do it twice as fast. And I do believe that the patients really do suffer. They feel that they're not being cared for. Now, whether their perception meets the reality, that is sometimes seen in complication and infection rates, but they feel that they're not being cared for, and that's huge.
And so I read these reports, and one report was specific about safety and these conditions that we're talking about here, both the conditions for the workers and also for patients that are byproducts of short staffing. I mean, tell me, is this the exception? Is this the rule? How prevalent is it?
Well, I think it's the rule. I mean, if you walk into any hospital, and we're talking about the tasks that the nurses are having to do, and we're in a computer age right now, and if you walk into any unit, sometimes the unit looks more like a data processing center than it does a hospital, because the nurses are constantly on the computers. And so that's taking a lot of the nurses' bedside time away. When they talk about shorting staffing, they're always talking about we're not going to affect bedside nursing. Well, you know what? If you take away the nurses are having to take out their own trash, they're having to do the nurses' aides jobs, take all of their vital signs on their own, you're taking away from the bedside care. And so it's obvious to me that it affects patient care. And this is the trend in the whole valley, because we know that, because we have 10,000 workers who are joining together and saying this is an issue.
Mm-hmm. So this, and actually you kind of answered my question that I'm about to ask you here about winning safe staffing in hospitals and our health facilities. It doesn't sound like this is some sort of special interest campaign. It sounds like it's more of a broader interest to the general public. I mean, is that how you would characterize it? Is that your goal here?
Yeah, I think that's our goal, is to make it safe across the whole state.
Well, and the hospitals will play up the big fact that there are not nurses. They are graduating nurses. Nurses are being turned out in the community with each graduation. They're not hiring new grads. There's empty positions at hospitals. But bigger than that is, it is in the public's interest to be well cared for, and to these hospital corporations. We have a large for-profit healthcare system in Las Vegas, and while that doesn't really matter to me, the profits should not be concentrated so that the patients are robbed of the care that they deserve.
So what are your challenges? What's the biggest challenge that you have? I'm sure you'll be talking about this tomorrow as you move forward with your plan and the strategies that you have. What are you identifying as, oh boy, you know, this is what we need to tackle here? Stephen, anybody?
Well, I think that there's going to be the last time that we went for a staffing bill, there was all kinds of pressure from people who get, when you go to the legislature, from politicians who get their donations from corporations and stuff like that. They're not willing to charge up the hill on our behalf or on the behalf of patients if they're not going to be supported. So I think some of our challenges are getting everybody to stay in this for the long haul until we get the job done.
And tell me about SEIU's role. What is the union's role in this whole thing?
Well, I think it's to take the 99% up to and take them up to Northern Nevada and show them that we care about our patients, and it's not about profits, it's not about corporations, it's about patients, and that's where we need to keep it.
Stephen, tomorrow, Saturday, we have the summit, and tell me a little bit about the program. What's going to happen tomorrow, and how is that going to get ready, the attendees ready for the plan to win later on in the legislative session?
Well, tomorrow we're going to speak to the past few meetings that our Healthcare Action Committee has had. We're going to speak to the history of healthcare, the healthcare industry in Las Vegas, and how that has brought rise to the conditions that we currently face in our hospital, and the steps that we need to take in order to challenge those obstacles, to win safe staffing, to win transparency legislation, and the like. So we will be putting out surveys and various new forms that can document working conditions, so that we can demonstrate that there are, in fact, these conditions in our hospitals when we go to the legislature in 2013.
You know, one of the ways I heard this described is staffing issues are a silent crisis. And so I want to put this out to everybody. You can all answer this, but talk to me about that part of this problem, and what message that you want to stick with not just the public, but also our members and your colleagues in the healthcare industry.
Well, if I could, I would just say that For too long, I think the discourse has been dominated by the hospital association and by the insurance companies. And for too long, healthcare workers, healthcare professionals have not had a seat at the table of discussion. And this is our opportunity to inject ourselves into that discussion, to have our voices heard, to give our perspective on what the conditions in the hospital are like.
Okay. Well, it sounds great. Would anybody like to add something to that? Or?
Well, just that this is a good forum. This is a great forum to break the silence in.
Very good. Well, we expect to have you all back to give us updates as we get closer to the legislative session and as you move forward on your work and have continued progress in both educating the public and, like I said, reaching your goals. I'm very excited about this summit tomorrow. I know that I will be there, and I'm looking forward to talking with everybody and learning even more about it. So I'm hoping that you all will be back soon. I see heads nodding.
Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. And I just want to remind everybody, you're listening to The New. We Are Nevada, your voice on the radio about issues that affect all of Nevada's working families. We're here every Friday, 9 a.m. at KLAV 1230, or streaming live on the internet at klav1230am.com. At the Minnesota State AFL-CIO Convention, Hubert Humphrey, the 38th Vice President of the United States, said, "The story of the labor movement needs to be taught in every school in this land. America is a living testimonial to what free men and women, organized in free democratic trade unions, can do to make a better life. We ought to be proud of it." This week in labor history, July 16, 1877. The great strike of 1877 that started in West Virginia halted the movement of U.S. railroads and spread across the United States. Clashes with police, militia, and even federal troops resulted in riots that continued well past the organized strike. The following week, in what would be known as the Battle of the Viaduct in Chicago, federal troops killed 30 workers and wounded over 100. The 1% of the time were so intimidated by the uprising that large stone armories were built in different parts of the country to protect them from what they saw as a people's revolt. Some of these armories are still standing today. The country was in the fourth year of a depression that followed years of greed, corruption, and capital accumulated by a group of young businessmen that included J.P. Morgan, Andrew Carnegie, Leland Stanford, and John Rockefeller. Railroads were the first business to really take off after the Civil War, but many of the smaller ones were going under as a result of the depression, bringing down farms and other businesses with them that relied on rail service to deliver raw materials and their finished goods. Those that remained in business were trying to squeeze workers with large pay cuts, sometimes by as much as 10%. The workday was based on miles, not hours, and these doubled in the period leading up to the strike. There were few successful unions in those days, and none were sanctioned by the government, making them all illegal. The Great Strike was really the first large-scale strike in the nation's history. July 17, 1944, two ammunition ships exploded at the Concord Naval Weapons Center in California, then known as Port Chicago. 322 people were killed, including 202 African Americans assigned by the Navy to handle explosives. The explosion was so large that it could be seen 35 miles away in San Francisco, across the bay. In response, 258 African Americans refused to return to the dangerous work, initiating what would be known as the Port Chicago Mutiny. 50 of the men were convicted. July 17, 1958. The death of a missile mechanic at Cape Canaveral sparked a successful four-day walkout that won improved local health and safety programs. And finally, on July 20, 1971, the first labor contract in the history of the federal government was signed by postal unions and the Postal Service through the collective bargaining process. This is our labor history for the week ending July 20. Okay, welcome back to We Are Nevada. We are on every Friday at 9 a.m. talking about labor issues. And right now I have my co-host, Leonard Cardinale. Leonard, why don't you give us an update on what's happening in North Las Vegas? It's a very serious situation there, and everybody should really know what's going on.
Thank you, Nick. Back in June, the mayor and city council of North Las Vegas decided to vote on a resolution that would allow the city to use an NRS out of 288, which is a collective bargaining laws, to go ahead and suspend certain parts of the public safety contracts under a natural disaster clause or under an emergency clause.
Oh, wait a second. Hold on. So natural disaster, are you talking about, like, was there an earthquake in North Las Vegas that I didn't know about or something like that?
No, that's true. There, even to this day, no emergency exists and no natural disaster exists. However, the city manager, Tim Hacker, predicts that there could possibly be a natural disaster if there were some public safety layoffs. and those layoffs have not occurred.
So wait a second. So the city manager is basically saying that the possibility, or through his prediction, that there might be a natural disaster, or this is very confusing.
Well, the language in the NRS is under a collective bargaining clause, which allows local governments to suspend certain parts of the contract under an emergency.
Well, has this been done before?
Not that I'm aware of, but this is the kind of situation where, let's say, for example, we have a flood. And during that flood, they have to deny leave time, and they have to deny a certain time off. They may have to have the officers work 12-hour shifts with no days off, depending on what kind of disaster there is. But keep in mind, once the emergency is over with, once the flood, for instance, is taken care of, there's no longer a suspension of contracts. And the way the city manager is going about this is almost like a permanent suspension, only because there's a possibility that there's a potential for an emergency.
But like, how do we get to this point? Because, look, I was at a city hall meeting in that luxurious city hall. It was beautiful. The most comfortable seats I've ever sat in. Believe me, I've sat in 8 hours at the Clark County Commission meetings and not very comfortable seats, but that city hall over in North Las Vegas, it's like one of the best movie theaters in town, that type of thing. Where is the money, and what's going on, and how did this all start?
Well, it all started back in 2005. Things were going really well in North Las Vegas, and of course, they were hit pretty tough economically, just like everywhere else, Las Vegas, Clark County, and throughout the United States. Well, the city would have you believe that they put up their $150 million city hall back in the days when things were good, and they also put up their water reclamation facility for $300 million. And keep in mind, when they built the water reclamation facility, they didn't have anywhere to dump the water. So they're still in a tangled situation with Clark County over dumping the water. And a lot of those issues were voted on in 2008 and 2009, and some of them even in 2010. So they're telling the public that these things occurred when there was a lot of money coming in and things were really rich in North Las Vegas, and yet they voted on them during some of our toughest financial times. Now you fast forward to the future, and the mismanagement of the city has caused a severe decline in tax income. And even to this day, businesses are not wanting to move to North Las Vegas, and residents are not wanting to move there, basically because the public safety numbers are down. The police department alone has less than half of the national average in police officers to protect and to patrol the streets.
Now, this is something I just don't get, because I remember I grew up in the New York City area during the 70s, and I remember all the financial issues that they were having and the big headlines in the Daily News where they were asking the government for money and there was no money to be had. And you couldn't walk the streets in New York City. You just couldn't. I remember my dad telling me he wouldn't even bring me into the city because just to walk down the streets was that dangerous. There was no money. There were no public services. There were no public safety workers. And I would think that by now, in this day and age, people would understand the importance of public safety workers, fire and police, and what it brings to the community, and how it's just a basic necessity. Are they ignoring this?
Well, I would have to say that North Las Vegas is experiencing something that's a bigger issue. As you know, throughout the nation and throughout the world, there are several governments that believe that austerity is the answer to all this, that cutbacks and draconian cuts and getting rid of public employees and cutting pay is really the answer. But what they've shown is that that's really not the answer, that austerity is really a political philosophy, and it's more of a conservative, and in this country possibly a Republican philosophy, where you try to combine services, you try to outsource services, you try to privatize services, and really what it's about is getting rid of public employees who have collective bargaining rights, and through those collective bargaining rights, it doesn't make them any richer or get them any more benefits. All collective bargaining does is give the employees a voice. It gives them a right to disagree with the local government entity that they're speaking with. Our city manager would have the public believe that we did not negotiate with the city of North Las Vegas when, in fact, when he went public and said we rejected their offers, we had not, the police supervisors had not even had their meeting with the city yet. So the city manager went out and started telling the public that the unions were not cooperating, and in fact, that was not true. Then when June 1st came around, the mayor sent us a letter, and the city manager both agreed that since we would not make a deal by June 1st, that they closed all negotiations, and there were going to be no deals, in their words. And to me, that sounds like a moratorium on public safety. That sounds like a moratorium on what the public has elected those persons and those elected people have appointed a city manager to try and work out something with the employee unions, and they absolutely refuse. They would rather just close the city down and outsource whatever services they can, including public safety.
It's kind of surprising because we know collective bargaining works. We've seen it in progress and in process over the past 40 years, and now all of a sudden we see both in North Las Vegas and even with teachers, we see almost like this bargaining in public where city managers and management that, like you said, sit across the table and hammer out these contracts with employees, now all of a sudden are holding press conferences and, you know, there seems like a lot of hyperbole and things going on. What, you know, what's changed? What, I don't understand, you know, what's going on?
I can tell you what our response was. I spoke to some news reporters who told me they spoke to Tim Hacker a couple of months ago, and the police supervisors invited the media to sit in on a meeting with the city to show who was really telling the truth about how the negotiations were going, who was really telling the truth about the possibility of concessions and where that was all headed. And I was told by a news source that they had spoken to Tim Hacker, and he agreed to have the media. In fact, he said he encouraged the media to be there and even asked one reporter to make sure that they share their information with the other news sources so it would not be exclusive. Well, the day before the meeting, we get a letter from the city attorney saying that they feel that it might be a violation of the open meeting law to allow the news to sit in on it, when clearly, if you read the NRS on the open meeting law, it does not apply to this particular situation. There was no city council at this meeting. There was no vote that was going to take place. There was no information that was going to be voted on and locked in on behalf of the citizens. This was simply a financial meeting to talk about finances and the possibility of how concessions may go if we were so inclined to talk about it. So we had nothing to hide. We were more than willing to let the media sit in and watch the meeting and really give the people and the public the real information firsthand and say, we went to the meeting today and this is what actually happened. So there was no spin on the real information.
Right. And we've had these conversations before. I've had these conversations with journalists before. And we've heard about it and whispered up in Carson City about this idea of bargaining becoming more transparent. And it's interesting to me that what you just said about the fact that it was ready to go and the 11th hour, a step was taken back and it didn't actually go through. Hey, I wanted to ask you a question because I just can't get out of my head this whole idea of a declaration of an emergency being made and all of a sudden contracts stopped. And one of the questions I have is, look, if there was a declaration of an emergency, what's the exact term for this that happened in North Las Vegas? Was it a declaration of emergency? Or what did they use to be able to suspend
the contract? They termed it a resolution.
Okay. So what other contracts were frozen? I mean, I must imagine that the city probably has contracts with a variety of different organizations and corporations and people. So how many other contracts were suspended?
Well, I would imagine a city the size of North Las Vegas has literally dozens or maybe hundreds of contracts with every kind of vendor that you can possibly think of. And to my knowledge, they've never broken a contract with any other organization. The only contracts that they want to suspend or that they have a problem with upholding their end of the bargain is the public employee contracts. And I think that's what this is all about. It would appear to us that this is nothing more than another method in which they can try to justify breaking a contract. And keep in mind, this is simple contract law, and that is why the police supervisors chose to go to district court, because in our attorney's opinion, this is simple contract law. We have a contract, and they're trying to break it by some kind of obscure law. Keep in mind, they're claiming that they may have or they do have a severe financial emergency. Well, severe financial emergency is defined under NRS 354. And under NRS 354, if a local government entity does in fact qualify for a severe financial emergency, there is about 27 criteria. Well, the city of North Las Vegas, the way I read it, do not fill any of that criteria. And they don't want to claim a severe financial emergency, because if they do, then the state would come in and the state would start to control and handle finances for the city of North Las Vegas. Well, they don't want that. So they want to appear as though they have a severe financial emergency under NRS 354, but at the same time, they want to use a collective bargaining NRS under 288 to try and suspend the contracts under something that is for civil disorder. And it's a military action and natural disaster. So they're trying to use all these examples of a time when you may have to suspend contracts, which do exist, but also always under the assumption that an emergency could occur if they lay off. Now, keep in mind, they were only talking about laying off 14 police officers. We have close to 300 commissioned police in North Las Vegas. So 14, I'm not sure 14 would cause a severe disaster under those particular circumstances. Also, from what I understand, this past weekend or a couple of weekends ago, there were brownouts at the fire stations. Two of the fire stations were browned out, and there were not enough fire personnel to man the engines. And again, I believe the city's response was that they have an ambulance service that they pay that's private that could go to most of those calls. So when you call, you may or may not get a paramedic firefighter, and that they're going to use other cities through a local agreement with Clark County and City of Las Vegas, and that they may cut down on your response time. And keep in mind, a few minutes during a medical emergency, 2 or 3 or 5 minutes extra to get to the person that's having the emergency could be the difference between making it through and not making it through.
So where is this now in the courts? Is it being challenged, or what's the next step on this?
I spoke to my attorney just a few days ago, and he advised me that the city has 20 days to respond to the complaint. I have not gotten a copy of the response at this point.
Where do you see this going? I mean, obviously from any person could see that, like I said, there's been no earthquake. There's no calamity that's happening in North Las Vegas. The severe financial emergency, it sounds to me from what you're describing that there's been a lot of posturing. Same thing with the open meeting, and then they backed off. The severe financial emergency, but they won't make the declarations or do the things they have to formalize it. So there's a lot of posturing, but no action. So where do you see this playing out?
Well, what was interesting is during the last city council meeting, Councilwoman Anita Wood made a statement, something to the effect that the unions are obviously in this to win, and they have to fight as hard as they can. And I didn't really understand the statement, and today I still don't understand the statement. There's no winning and losing here. They gave the police supervisors no choice. They decided to use a part of the NRS that does not apply to contractual matters to violate our contract, to go ahead and take items that they were not willing to sit down and negotiate. So we really had no choice but to defend ourselves. And as you know, in district court or any other court, you can never predict how it's going to go. It could go one way or the other. And I think the people that are really losing here, I think who's really losing are the citizens of North Las Vegas, because they have a mayor and a city council and a city manager that would rather spend millions of dollars over the last several years fighting employees and fighting public unions and trying to bring them and forcing them to bring them to court, forcing them to file EMRB complaints, forcing them to file grievances which result in arbitration. And the city will fight all the way through to district court, to Supreme Court, for as long as it takes, and spend a countless amounts of money to fight, rather than just have a city manager who has enough experience and enough negotiating skills and has the right education and the right experience to be able to sit down with the leaders of the public employee unions and kind of find solutions that benefit everyone, especially the citizens. This is more of a personal fight that the elected have taken on, a personal fight that the appointed have taken on against the public employee unions. And they're willing to use the citizens' tax dollars to the tunes of millions of dollars if they have to, just to fight it. So really, there is no winner and loser in this.
Leonard, I've heard you talk really passionately about unionism and what it means to you. And you're a sergeant in North Las Vegas. And I just want to ask you, what does it mean to be a police officer, serving the community? Why are you doing it?
I think the police officers in North Las Vegas and the police supervisors, in my experience, are some of the proudest, most dedicated public servants and law enforcement personnel that there's ever been. Morale has never been lower. The police department administration is not concerned about morale. They're trying to help the city at every turn to try and dismantle the police department. And even though the morale is low, and even though it looks like there's some bad things coming, there's some bad stuff on the horizon, such as outsourcing some of our services and such as privatizing some of our services. There's no promotions planned. There's no hiring plan. There's no testing plan for new officers. So things are going to get much tougher in the city of North Las Vegas. However, you will see when you look at the crime stats that the crime is not really getting that much worse. So to me, that means that the supervisors and the officers are going out there every night and they're doing their job regardless of how we're being treated, regardless of the lack of respect that has been shown toward the employees and toward the rights of the employees.
Well, Leonard, thank you very much for bringing us up to date on that. I know we'll be following this as we move forward. It's made national news. I saw it even made Yahoo News. You know, when something makes Yahoo News, that means it's everywhere in the world, I suppose. But it's a very serious topic because it's something that is indicative of what is occurring to all unions throughout Southern Nevada and also the country. And we'll be looking forward to more of your updates. Thanks.
Let's talk about PERS, man.
Oh, that sounds like a great idea. What'd you have in mind?
Well, you know, there was an interesting article in Smart Money online about 401k fees and comparing defined benefit plans with defined contribution plans. And, you know, it's only reinforcing how I make the distinction between the two plans, but I want to, you know, hear your thoughts about it because, you know, this is a topic I know we're going to be talking a lot about, pensions.
We are. We're going to spend some time on this in the next show, but let me throw out a quick thought. A defined benefit versus defined contribution. One important aspect is, let's say you get hired by a local government entity that is paying into PERS, and you don't stay for 5 years. You don't become vested. You stay 3.5 years. And let's say there's thousands of those people that don't make it to the five-year mark. Well, even though the local government entity is paying into PERS, you don't get that money back. You'll never see that money. If you're paying into a 401k style, a defined contribution, and you don't make it to a certain point, you may take a penalty for taking your money with you, but you can actually take it with you. And that's an important part about having a public employee retirement system, is that it's self-contained in a way, in a manner that the 401k style is not.
Look, Leonard, I'm going to tell you right now, this is the way I describe it to everybody. Defined contribution plan contributes to the pockets of the 1%. Defined benefit plan benefits the people, the pensioners, the public, and the taxpayers, because it's accountable, right? The way we have the system set up here, the whole thing is accountable to the public because it's controlled by this board, and the board makes very conservative investments to make sure that the people that need to be taken care of are taken care of. The defined contribution plan, right, they invest in the interest of the shareholders. Now, we know what happens when people work on behalf of the shareholders. We saw it with the tech stock crash. We saw it with our housing crash. You know, it's money, 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 right? But the system that we have now, it basically takes this huge pool of money and it invests it in a really responsible way.
Well, they would like to take the money that's in PERS and invest it in a 401k style contribution plan. But that would be like getting your Social Security and, instead of collecting a check, taking your Social Security and investing that. And I don't think people would want that either.
Now, we have a lot to talk about this, and I just want to remind everybody, you're listening to the new We Are Nevada. This is your voice on the radio about issues that affect all of Nevada's working families. We Are Nevada can be heard every Friday morning at 9 a.m. on KLAV 1230 a.m. or streaming live on the internet at KLAV 1230 am.com. I want to thank everyone for joining us this week. Leonard, it's been a blast.
Yeah, it's been great. Join us Friday mornings and tell your friends about it. And I think next week we'll be taking some phone calls. So thank you, everyone, for listening today. And Nick, great show. Thank you.
All right.